good morning and welcome to worship on this beautiful day. We are going to begin our worship together with a Christmas carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem. This morning, we continue to celebrate Christmas. The Christmas season is 12 days, and so we are able to continue to celebrate the birth of Christ and to reflect on what that means for us in our daily lives. I encourage you to check out the announcements. As you have noticed, we are listing people in our bulletin and on our prayer list. And if there is someone you would like to have us pray for, be sure to get their permission so that we can list them. And you will notice that the tear-off sheet that we ask you to fill out indicates that you can give us prayer requests and also identify if you want them in our prayer list, or prayer chain, or both. You will see as well that you can indicate if you would like a pastor to reach out to you and contact you in any way. So we look forward to a new year and new opportunities. Pastor David is off today, but he will be here next Sunday when I will take the weekend off, and so we have you covered. Please note the other announcements in there, especially the book study that Pastor David is starting the first week of January. Also note the news from the Hanover Area Council of Churches. And we want to thank you for your generosity with all of the special outreach ministries that we have had and for the ongoing ministry of St. Matthew and your faithful offerings. Please note that for your offerings for this year, we would like to receive them by noon on Tuesday the 29th. The church will be closed tomorrow, December 28th, but open again Tuesday morning. We continue our worship with our confession and forgiveness. You'll find that on page 4 in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who was in the beginning, who makes a dwelling among us, who covers us with justice and mercy. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. We take a few moments for silent prayer. God of goodness and loving kindness, we confess that we have sinned against you and our neighbors. We have turned away from your invitation to new life. We have turned away from the lowly and downtrodden. In your abundant mercy, forgive us our sins, those we know and those known only to you. For the sake of the one who came to live among us, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Hear the good news of peace and salvation. God forgives us all our sins, not through our own work, but through Jesus Christ, made known to all people. With all who come to the manger, rejoice in this amazing gift of grace. Amen. And we sing our opening hymn. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, you wonderfully created the dignity of human nature, and yet more wonderfully restored it. In your mercy, let us share the divine life of the one who came to share our humanity, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I read to you the Holy Gospel according to Luke, the second chapter. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace be to you from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Jesus doesn't stay in the manger long, and the magic of Christmas does not last. A cartoon in the New Yorker magazine says it all. This was from many years ago. In the middle of the floor is a dried up, withered Christmas tree. The calendar on the wall reads December 26th. Dad is sitting in his chair with an ice pack on his head. Mom is in a bathrobe and her hair in rollers. See what I mean? This was from years ago. The floor is a virtual mountain of torn wrappings, boxes, and bows. Junior is reaching in his stocking to be sure that there is no more candy. In the background, we see a table with a thoroughly picked turkey still sitting there. The caption on the cartoon reads simply, "The morning after." For us, this may capture not only Christmas, but the whole year of 2020. The morning after Christmas puts us not only in a post-holiday slump, but we continue to live this pandemic slump. The reality of this, as you know and experienced, had us temper our usual get-togethers and face up to a stalled economy hampered by the safety restrictions of our activities. As our Christmas debts come due, Many are burdened with the uncertainty of a stable income. And so on this Sunday after Christmas, we shiver in the cold reality of our plight. Although a vaccine is making its way to us, we have a difficult winter ahead. Some may find hope in the long promised but yet to be realized relief bill, but the problems are complex, and any trust that exists is fragile. It's the morning after, and we now face many morning afters to come. In the gospel reading today, we find Jesus not in the manger, but in the temple. And if we listen closely to Simeon, we discover that he is not a character out of a Hallmark Christmas movie. You could say that in some ways, Simeon is like our Dr. Fauci, who may bring good news, but it comes with a lot of bad news first. Isn't that true? Here is Simeon. We find that he tells a most compelling truth about this child, the truth which cuts through the false pretenses of cheer and drives to the heart of reality. But first, let us pay attention to what Simeon does not say. He does not claim that Jesus will meet our every expectation for the good life, whatever that may be. Neither does Simeon predict a smooth journey in our day-to-day lives, nor does he create a picture of perfect success. And I must add, Simeon does not and cannot promise that this baby in his arms will be the shot in the arm that inoculates us from all afflictions. What Simeon does claim is this: the Savior of the world is destined for us, destined for the morning after, for our slumps, and is also set for our fall. The consolation comes, but it comes at a great cost. This child was born to die. But here is the message of hope. This child is destined for us who know that there is no escape from reality. And it is true, there is no vaccine that protects us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. There is no relief bill that will give us relief from the sorrow of loss and disappointment. And for us who know the whole story, who realize that the Christmas story is just a beginning, we realize that indeed there is another morning after. It is a morning shortly after people gathered around another tree, not decked out with decorations, but instead stripped bare with our Savior hanging on it. Instead of empty boxes and unfulfilled expectations, we celebrate this morning with an empty tomb, and unimaginable possibilities. Easter is our morning after, and that is why I love that whether we are inside the church or outside in the parking lot of St. Matthew, it is the resurrection window that reminds us of our true hope and real joy. It is the resurrection that reveals the true meaning of Christmas. A Savior set for the falling and rising. This was the message that gave hope to a member of my internship church in Brooklyn, New York. One morning, many years ago, when I was at this church for a year, two policemen entered my office in this inner city church and asked for the pastor. I had been an intern there for about 8 months, and my supervisor decided that I was ready to be on my own, so he took vacation and put me in charge. "Are you Carl Olson's pastor?" the police asked. With a big gulp, I said, "Yes." "You need to come with us," the one police officer said. So here's what happened. Jenny Olson, a longtime member of the church, found her 92-year-old husband in the cellar. As she walked down the steps, she saw to her absolute horror that he had hung himself. Jenny's scream alerted her neighbor, who then called the police. I was the next one to be reached. As I arrived at their home, I saw two officers in the cellar investigating the scene and guarding the body of Carl. I had just seen him the week before. He was battling painful bone cancer. He was most concerned about how his wife and son could handle his illness. I suspect that he did this as an attempt to spare them. If only he knew how much pain he brought them. After my quick glance down into the cellar, I ran up the steps to Jenny. I found her sitting all alone. For several minutes, we sat quietly in the silence. I tried to imagine what she was thinking or feeling. She shook her head. She moaned. She cried. Every so often, I noticed that she would tremble. Her hands felt ice cold next to my own palms, which held them. Finally, Jenny spoke. She asked the question which was foremost on her mind. Her whole life, she had been consoled by God's love. But now, she wondered, could it be that her husband had slipped out of the graces of God when he dared to take his own life? Her question, directed to me, was spoken in a timid and fearful tone. "You don't suppose that he is with God, do you?" "I don't suppose," I told her. And remembering what I learned at seminary about salvation and Jesus' death, I said, "I know that Carl is with God. For him, our God came. He died and rose for Carl." There's more to that story. Their adult son was at work at the local post office. He was one who had autism. When he was a child, his Sunday school teacher unknowingly told his mother something that would keep their son away from church for years and years and years. And that is, the Sunday school teacher said, "You know, he's having trouble in our class, and I'm not sure how to help him." In my visit with them, when their son finally got home, and I could recognize the characteristics because of my own brother, I simply said, "Why don't you come to church this Sunday? There are many people there who will want to show their love to you. And the power of a gathered community of believers changed his life and his mother's, for they did welcome them. And in fact, from that day forward, their son Norman was an usher every Sunday. I know that God sent his son for each and every one of us. Our God has come to us in a child destined for the falling and rising of many. And for you, this child is set for you, even as you move into a new year with your jobs and tend to your children, as you get back to school, whether it's virtual or in person or both, as you deal with the hassles of daily life, Jesus has moved from the manger and into your life. As the gifts are put away and the decorations placed in boxes, as the trees are taken down and the lights disassembled, even after the last cookie is eaten, the spirit of Christmas remains steadfast. In or out of season, there is no escape from the love of God. For we see what Simeon sees, salvation prepared in the presence of all peoples, better than any vaccine or relief bill imagined. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Soon deliver.
so much, Leah and Ashley. And we thank Scott for his wonderful support of our young musicians throughout the year. We are so blessed. Let us confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Joining our voices with the song of the angels, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Night and day, all creation praises you, O God. Strengthen your church across nations, denominations, and traditions. Fill us with wisdom and unify our proclamation of your forgiveness and mercy. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. The nations are upheld by your hand, O God. Cause righteousness and praise to spring forth, inspiring leaders to serve with compassion and integrity. Send your spirit of discernment upon legislators grappling with complex decisions for the sake of the common good. We pray for all impacted in Nashville by the tragedy. We thank you for the safety of so many, for the wisdom of the leaders. We pray for your guidance. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Send the spirit of your Son into our hearts, O God. Come quickly to hearts that race with fear, hearts that break with grief, and hearts that long for wholeness. Especially Yvonne, Chris, Bill, Anne, Betty, Carol, John, Bob, Hannah, Vicky, Bob, Nathan, Pastor Ruth, Larry, Lindsay, Nan, Joyce, Barry, Sally, our homebound, all in this world impacted by COVID-19, and others we name before you aloud or in our hearts. Reveal your power to heal and to save. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Adopt us into your family, O God. Bless our elders with the peace and joy of Simeon and Anna. Strengthen those who have retired, those who work in older age, and those in need of income, food, company, or health care. Connect young and old across the generations. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Let us depart in peace, O God, according to your word. Prepare our salvation in the sight of all your witnesses of every time and place. God of mercy, come quickly to us with grace upon grace as we lift these and all our prayers to you. In the name of Jesus, amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Thank you. you know, we're going to get into traffic jams and we're going to hear all these horns and we're going to think that they're all sharing the peace with us. Which wouldn't be a bad thing, would it? We continue our worship as we receive the gift of the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he gave thanks. He gave the cup to all, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word is revealed in a manger, in simple bread and wine. Come, meet Christ in this meal. All are welcome. Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us from your very self with the body and blood of Christ. Through this mystery, send us forth to proclaim your promise to a world in need. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Receive God's blessing. Almighty God, who sent the Holy Spirit to Mary, proclaimed joy through the angels, sent the shepherds with good news, and led the Magi by a star, bless you this day through the Word made flesh. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our closing hymn, "Go Tell It on the Mountain."
Go tell it on the mountain.
It was wonderful being here together with you and to worship under this beautiful sunshine. And I thank our parking attendants and worship assistants when they volunteered last May. They had no idea that they would be out here at the end of December and into the winter. But God is good, and we are so blessed. Go in peace. Share the gift of Jesus. Thanks be to God.